Finding yourself in the talons of an owl and the shadows of the forest moonlight, it's a gruesome affair. There was a secret door in our basement. I hated being down there because I heard scratching and strange clicking noises coming from the depths behind the door. Not to mention, I often saw those nasty gray pill bugs walking on the old burgundy-colored tile floor near the secret door. So when I would be down there, I would listen. I would listen with dread, and the things I heard kept me from opening that door when I was alone down there. I tried to stay upstairs in that house. The irony is that our family would, a few years later, move to a well-known haunted house. But this house in Larchmont, New York, had plenty of its own unexplained quirks. The house had multiple secret compartments, an abandoned dumbwaiter, a treacherous beamed attic, and the basement was one you could get lost in. The huge stone house was at the top of a hill that ended in a cul-de-sac, so we had our own little world up there. We knew the families living in the neighboring houses well. It was a safe and beautiful place, except for all the strange happenings. We've said many times we could write a book about it all. The stories are coming out now in small waves, like this very story about our own private dead human skeleton we kept in our underground wine cellar. That basement was always colder than the rest of the house. It had that damp, moldy feeling that makes you aware that you are underground. The rear windows were at the top of the walls and were more like small windows peering out into dark manholes that opened up above, hungry for whatever light there might be in the shadows of the shrubs around the perimeter of the house. There was a fireplace, an old wooden bar, and some outdated leather sofas that were always cold on the skin. The walls had dark natural wood trim that covered the bottom half. The only reliable light down there was an antique metal frame mirror. This mirror formed a sort of sun or metal sunflower about 3 feet in diameter, with metal leaflets illuminated by small red glowing bulbs hidden behind the centerpiece mirror. I might add that the walls and floor of this room were in the color burgundy. That's right, I can't imagine that anyone would choose a dark shade of red to color a basement room, but let's just say my grandparents were Italian. No wonder the spirits were restless in our huge suburban home. When you come down the basement stairs, one stands in a corridor, gazing into the dark burgundy room. At the opposite end is the secret door. It wasn't that much of a secret, as there was clearly the outline of a door on the wall with a small latch, something like those on an outdoor wooden fence. I was down there with my mother on Halloween that last year we lived in that house. I was 11 at that time. We were down there to get our skeleton, to set up our house for the trick-or-treaters who would be visiting us that evening. We opened the secret door, which behind it one finds another door set about a foot behind the first door. The second door was clearly an antique, with heavy horizontal panels of thick, dark wood and an old skeleton key lock. The lock was opened, and my mother turned the knob and opened the door. I stepped back and watched while trying not to. Opening the door revealed what was inside, and it was looking straight at me. Its skull was pointed at me, exactly, and the hollows of its eyes were pointed at me, also exactly, and its jaw was open like it was enjoying something. Actually, its open jaw made me feel like the skeleton was excited to have that wooden door unlocked and a visit from the living. I tried not to look. But I looked, and I looked away, and then I looked back at it staring at me with that evil jaw smile. From the vantage point that I was standing, the room behind the second door just seemed like blackness. It is actually a small subterranean wine cellar. This small room is hardly the size of a closet, with floor-to-ceiling wood shelves that had been carved to store wine bottles in a manner to keep the corks moist with wine. but there were only a few random bottles. They were old, too old. We didn't know where they came from and never opened them. Everything was covered in a thick layer of dust, the kind of dust you get when things haven't been dusted for decades. This dust makes one sick and repulsed. The skeleton was not something we wanted to see in our daily lives, so this dark subterranean wine cellar was the resting place for our real human skeleton every night of the year except one, Halloween. I didn't like living in a home with a real human skeleton. My father is an orthopedic surgeon. Among his collection of strange surgical equipment, literature on anatomy, models of human parts and organs and the like, was his real skeleton. It was a scientific, educational item, but I never saw it used for that. The only time I ever saw it was on Halloween. That's when we got its money's worth. Whoever the skeleton had been, somebody should have told him he'd eventually have a job giving candy to children in costumes for decades, maybe centuries after his death. For all I know, he might still be out there somewhere on Halloween this year in 2018 and beyond. The skeleton wasn't just white. Certain sections, like the clavicula and the area where the ribs converge at the sternum, were kind of yellowed. It also had some notes of subtle color coding on the left side, his right, that is. These were medical markings about ligaments, nerves, and muscles, but mostly archaic Latin words that added to the mystique. In this way, you can learn a bit about anatomy while getting the heebie-jeebies scared out of you. The skeleton was suspended on a rolling five-wheeled stand, so it could be wheeled around. On this Halloween, we rolled it out and dusted it off. We had to carry it up the stairs to set up our scary scene in the hallway. My mother tried the cord suspending the skeleton. Here's where things get creepy, or creepier. The skeleton is a bit heavy. It is the entire collection of bones from a dead person. On her first attempt, the skeleton was staring at me, so I changed position and walked around to the other side. She muscled the skeleton and failed. It rotated around and stopped staring dead at me with that sick, jovial, skeletal smile. I think you know what I'm talking about. I will never forget that skeleton tormenting me like that. On the second attempt, she succeeded and she held the skeleton like they were hugging. She walked out of the room, and of course, the skeleton's skull was perched over her left shoulder, and it was staring at me like it does, with that unsettling smile. I felt like it was ecstatic to be getting some attention and get out of its room to have some fun. As my mother's steps made the skull bob a bit up and down, the skeleton seemed to be expressing the bliss of the attention and excitement. It was like a special needs member of the family, and this is his day where he gets to go out and have fun. Only he's dead. Like, far dead. Just bones. She plopped him down on an antique wooden chair in the hallway on the ground level, so that when you enter the front door of the house, you have to walk down the hallway to be greeted by our dead host. She said, "There you go, Frederick. You're going to have a lot of visitors tonight." Frederick is what she, and coincidentally others, called the skeleton as well. She had names for our maid and butler. We didn't actually have a maid or butler. They were imaginary, but I saw them in the reflection of a window one night. But that is also a story for another time. My costume was a vampire on this year, that last Halloween in Larchmont. My mother had sewed the cape, so it was a real black velvet cape. She had placed a large pasta-serving bowl on Frederick's lap and filled it with candy, small Snickers bars, Three Musketeer bars, and Milky Way bars. There were some loose Starburst chews and loose Hershey's Kisses in the mix. She was always pestering me to pose for photos. She asked me to stand next to Frederick in my cape getup, sitting there with the large ceramic bowl filled with the mixed candy. I did not want to go near that thing. I just wanted to meet my friends and go out trick-or-treating like a normal kid would, but she insisted. I walked over and stood there next to that sitting skeleton and was relieved that it was not staring at me in this rare instance. This was still the era when photos were taken with 35mm film. She had a large Kodak camera, and as she was looking through the viewfinder, adjusting the focus, I felt disgusted. It just felt too real, and I felt frozen, like in that moment, it felt like Halloween really was a night for the dead, and that the dead have ideas and goals and are real like we are. I felt sick and glanced several times at Frederick's skull and was relieved to find that the hollows of his eyes were not fixed on me. Then it hit me. He is looking at and posing for the camera. My mother was making some adjustments on the camera lenses, and I felt it. It was like a little bird landed on my right shoulder. I froze and my blood ran cold. This is not possible. I reached up to feel it. Frederick's bony hand was on my shoulder, like he had his arm around me. I screamed and jumped. I did not want to be near that thing. I ran into the kitchen and peeled open a Snickers bar to keep myself busy. As my mother came in, I said, "There is something not right with that thing." She also had a look on her face like she had seen a ghost. "I know," she said. Shortly after, a friend of mine arrived and we headed out to do some good old-fashioned trick-or-treating. This part of the night was great, actually. We were a vampire and a mummy, so we were spooky characters systematically gathering our candy from the neighborhood houses. There was one house that had a haunted house. They definitely put more effort into it than our skeleton attraction, but the skeleton repulsed me like nothing else on Halloween. I used a pillowcase in navy blue for my candy bag. I have to admit, it was getting pretty heavy when we got back, and when I did, I took my shoes off and started organizing the night's score. I grouped the candies, Twix bars here, Skittle packets there. My mother came up and told me that a small girl had come by in a group of three dressed as a princess. This girl had walked into our hallway, headed down towards the skeleton and candy bowl, had taken a Snickers bar, and then looked at the skeleton and uttered the words,
"Thank you, Frederick."
It's possible that this girl, who we didn't know, had heard someone else call him that, but my mother thought it was uncanny and had been upset by this. Guess our trick-or-treaters were also able to scare us. Around midnight, the father of the neighboring house came by, and I came out to the front yard to see what was going on. His name was Mr. Dimitri, and he asked me if I was the one who had kicked his pumpkin. He was very upset because not only had the pumpkin been trashed, but there were pumpkin guts all over his front door. I told him I did not do it. He then walked over to our front door, peered into our foyer, and then leaned in to pick something up. I'll never forget this. He picked up my right shoe, and it was drenched in pumpkin guts. This shoe was looking as guilty as a pumpkin-kicking shoe could. Mr. Dimitri looked at me and said,
"Are you still sure you didn't kick it?"
One of the worst feelings is getting blamed for something you didn't do. This Halloween Eve did not stop getting strange there. When we came into the house, we noticed the large pasta bowl had been placed on the tiles of the hallway floor. Frederick was gone. This was, to say the least, odd. Nobody had been in our house while Mr. Dimitri was over, and I saw Frederick sitting in the hall earlier when I got back from trick-or-treating. Our skeleton had been there before, and it was gone now. My mother and I went down into the basement looking for Frederick. When you get to the base of the stairs, the hallway is well lit, and there's a bathroom with a very unusual crescent moon-shaped window on its door. We stood in the hallway and looked into the burgundy room. It had been daytime when we were down there earlier. Although the windows are underground, they allow in enough light to see during daytime. The only light that worked down there was the glowing red metal mirror on the wall. She stepped in and flipped the switch so that the mirror glowed red and the room, though dark, At least there was some kind of light. Then I said, "Let me get up to my room and get my flashlight." I quickly went up and got the flashlight and came back down, pointing the flashlight at the secret door. We both saw the secret door was closed. My mother opened it. The door creaked as it opened. Set a foot back, the second door was also closed. My mother pushed the second door while trying to stand as far from it as one can while pushing a door. I stepped back, holding the flashlight aimed into the wine cellar. I tried to hold it steady, but couldn't hide my trembling. The door swung back slowly, revealing Frederick, our skeleton, laying on the floor with his head propped up on the lowest wine rack. He was staring right at me, with that devilish skeleton, bony and toothsome jaw smile. I hated that thing when it looks at me like that. It's an expression like it knows that it's tormenting me. I pointed the flashlight at the bony right ankle and was disgusted to see that the white bone of his lower leg was covered in pumpkin mush. My stomach sunk. The cold, musky basement air was still. Was it possible? It couldn't be. A skeleton could not put my shoes on and kick the neighbor's pumpkin. Or could it? I don't know. We shut the doors to that wine cellar and left Frederick in there on the floor. We went quickly up the stairs. That was the last time I would ever see that skeleton. We moved away the summer of the following year. I recently asked everyone in the family whatever happened to that skeleton. And as far as I understand, we just left it there, and no one has seen it since. At least, no one from my family. Smoking Owl here. I really enjoy these horrible stories and hope that you do too. If so, please rip at the like button and scratch a comment. And best of all, help me on the path to 100 subscribers by subscribing now. And catch you on another night very soon. Very soon.